Okay, well, welcome everybody here today for this interesting seminar on the Environment Bill, the subject that everybody in the Green Party is talking about at the moment, or at least it is the subject that everybody in the Green Party should be talking about at the moment, because it's incredibly important. It's dealing with farming, waste management, biodiversity, air pollution, animal protection, pesticides, plastics, all the things that are affecting our environment at the moment and need dealing with. And with us leaving the EU, of course, that means that there are going to have to be new mechanisms put into place to be able to deal with keeping and ensuring that our environment is protected. And the new Office of Environmental Protection will be replacing a lot of EU bodies which used to keep an eye on what we were doing in terms of environmental legislation. I'll be chairing today's session. I'm Andrew Cooper. I'm a Kirklees councillor in Kirklees in West Yorkshire. And we have our two members of the House of Lords, Baroness Jenny Jones of Moulscombe and Natalie Bennett of Manor Castle in Sheffield. That's where Manor Castle is. So we're going to be kicking off shortly with Jenny, who will speak for about 10 minutes. And then Natalie, who will speak for roughly about another 10 minutes. And then it's over to you with questions. So please use the Q&A function there. I'll be monitoring the Q&A and I'll be fielding that to both Jenny and Natalie as we go along. So without further ado, let's go straight to Jenny Jones.
Thank you, Andy. And I'd like to say thank you to the Green Party for actually allowing us to do this or setting it up so that we can, because there is nothing we like more than speaking about our work. And quite often when we say what we do in the House of Lords, nobody knows what to ask us. So this is a really good opportunity for us to explain exactly where we are, especially on a bill of, as Andy said, such importance. So I'm going to explain the process for legislation that goes through, because without it, it's quite difficult to follow what we're going to be saying perhaps next. So there's several stages for every piece of legislation. Most of it comes from the Commons and then comes to the House of Lords. And mostly when it comes to the Commons, it's a bit threadbare, it's a bit thin, it doesn't really do the job that we think it should do. And so we amend it. So first reading is where they literally just say the name of the bill and nothing happens. Second reading is when every single person in the House who wants to comes in and talks about all the issues that they think should be in the bill and whether or not they think it's covered. And there are no votes or anything like that because there's no amendments. Next is committee stage, where there are a flood of amendments. I think for the Environment Bill, there were 300. It's the most amendments I've ever known. And so they allocated a huge amount of time for committee stage. Committee stage is when we all put amendments and you can start to see who shares your concerns about various things, you know, whether it's plastics, pesticides, air pollution, whatever. And then all of those amendments are grouped. And unlike the Commons, every single amendment is debated. In the Commons, the Speaker chooses, but in the House of Lords, everything gets debated. So we have just finished committee stage. It was 8 days of debate. It went on quite a long time. And see, Natalie's nodding. And we are now in the autumn going to move into report stage. In the autumn, the House of Lords only sits for 2 weeks because then we're off for a month of conference season, and it's a ridiculously short amount of time that we sit, but it means that we are going to do the rest of the Environment Bill in that bit. And it's report stage, and that's when there's fewer amendments. We've talked more to people. We're deciding who should be on our amendments. For example, we're allowed 4 signatures. So what we would do is ask 3 other people to sign up. Natalie and I tried very, very roughly at the start. I don't know if you can see this sheet of paper with tiny, tiny writing on it. No, you probably can't. But that is our division of issues. Now, we can't entirely divide them in half because some of them overlap and some are just not quite stuff that we cover. So, but we have tried to separate them out. So report stage is when we start voting, and that's when it really matters that you've got the right amendment that will get the support of the House, and we vote, and then we send it back to the Commons. So that's what's going to happen in September. A bit later, say October, no, November, gosh, November, it's October, yeah. October, we will have a ping pong with the Commons. So what they will do is they'll look at all of our amendments, they'll throw them all out because they have an 80 plus majority, and they'll send the bill back unamended. Very occasionally they give way on something, but we're an 80 plus majority, they don't really have to. And then we have ping pong when we keep sending it backs and forwards, but being the unelected chamber, we can't insist. So hopefully we will have an environment bill for COP26 and it will be a good one, but it's very much fingers crossed, and I'm not actually very optimistic. Over to Natalie.
Okay, well, I thought feeding on from that, the question is, you know, how do we actually work on this bill and how can people on this webinar get involved? What's happening? So, I mean, on lots of these issues, what as Greens we should be doing, what we're saying, and just so blindingly obvious, on lots of bills, I spend lots of my time going, and what about climate change, putting down amendments like that? And what about biodiversity? And I've just come out of the skills and post-16 education bill doing a great deal of that. But of course, we also get new ideas. We try to work with the policy working groups and the Policy Development Committee. And that's something that I think the Green Party is starting to develop and work with. So if there's a particular area that you're interested in, you might well want to look at, see where what policy working group there is that you might want to get engaged and involved in. And that's a way in which you can work with others to feed things into us. We also get approached a lot by NGOs, and sometimes we come up with things ourselves, but also sometimes fairly unusually, but I had an unusual experience with this. I was approached by the aluminium industry, which wanted to make a point about the bottle deposit scheme, that thing that we've been waiting forever. And I thought they had a good case. And so I put their case and an amendment about the bottle scheme, that there should be different amounts of deposit for different size of containers, because otherwise you end up with four giant plastic bottles being only a fraction of the cost of a collection of aluminium cans, when aluminium is actually recycled far more and can be recycled indefinitely in the way that plastic can't. So we get input from people like that. I also worked with the Nappy Alliance, which is a representative of the reusable nappy companies and campaigners. It's a cross group, and they came an amendment which came from Commons that I'm going to look to again down a report. So there's lots of opportunities. We don't just sit there and think this is what we're going to do. We get feeding from the Green Party. We get feeding from NGOs and charities. And there's a couple of the people who are well worth following in social media, if you don't already, is the Green Alliance, which is one of the groups that's very much sort of coordinating amendments, because particularly once we get to report, we'll be looking to try and make sure that this is so we can get the maximum number of amendments passed through the House. We can make the bill as we possibly can, strong as we can, when it leaves our House. And that increases the chances of just winning, making a little bit more victory over the government. So we almost never get what we want, but we do see shifts. And that's the important thing, I think. So we've now done all the boring procedural stuff. We'll get into the meat now, but I'll hand back to Andrew first before we do that.
So first question, and people please do use the Q&A to ask questions. Does the bill incorporate the findings of the Dasgupta report? And if so, what sort of value might get put on nature we arrive at? Do you think it will be effective? Who wants to handle that one?
I'll start. No, it doesn't incorporate anything like the Dasgupta report, because the government's just doesn't get the whole climate agenda stuff. I bumped into a minister the other day and he said, look, I want to reassure you that we want the same things that you do, but we just don't want this fast. And obviously physical violence is a no-no, but really what a stupid thing to say, because the whole point is that we have to react fast. There's an urgency. So no, the DA's got to report. The only way any of it gets in is through our amendments. I don't know if Natalie agrees with that.
Very much so. And I think it's worth saying that this, and Jenny knows more about this than I do, but this is the Environment Bill started back in 2018. And of course, so much has moved on in our understanding, in the degree of urgency, in the level of acceptance, at least in rhetoric, even from the government, of the need to act on these issues, that the bill looks horribly out of date. And I think if we tie it to DA's book, the obvious thing to relate this to, and this is a nice example of how campaigning, both what we do in the House and outside, does make progress happen, is I'm sure many people on this call will have signed what was known for shorthand as the State of Nature petition. I think the last figure I saw was 240,000 people had signed it, calling for a nature target, which would match, just as we have a carbon target, that we should have a 2030 State of Nature target. Now, what happened with that was George Eustace went off to a forest in the Midlands somewhere, I've forgotten which forest it was now, and gave this big announcement and said, yes, we're going to have a 2030 State of Nature target. And everyone went, yay, 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 campaigning works. And then when the government actually put down the amendment to this, it was incredibly weak. It doesn't really contain a State of Nature report at all. In fact, I'll stick a link in a second in the chat to the debate where the speech I made in this debate, because basically, and the response from the minister was really interesting, from this is Zach Goldsmith, because he basically said, oh, well, you're asking us to turn things straight around, but things are going to get worse in terms of the state of nature before they get better, which is really quite a horrifying statistic, and something I'm going to write a comment piece about when I get a chance. And so what we'll be doing, and what you know, people like the Green Alliance, who I mentioned before, will be doing, is coming back with our own amendments at report stage to actually create a decent state of nature target. And that's very much related to DA's book. It's something to watch out for, because you'll probably see a lot of campaigning around this. And the practical reality is probably, as Jenny said, amendments can only have four names on them. We probably won't have our name on that amendment, because to maximise the chance of an amendment being passed, the general rule of thumb is you want a Tory, a crossbencher, that's a non-party person, Labour and Lib Dem, which demonstrates their support. And that's the best way to get the maximum number of votes. So on lots of occasions, we don't put our name down because there's only four slots, which is one of the things that I'm quite often battering the House about, because in the Commons, six people could put their names down. And given we now have a multi-party nation, we need more slots so that we could show our support. But such are the things that occupy our days. You know, we go from state of nature protecting species to how many signatures there are on amendment, but that's life.
Okay. So next question is from Gloria Basoli. And her question is, can we shame the Commons for accepting your amendments in view of the COP? So Boris Johnson, Shane, anybody want to tackle that one?
It's a very simple answer, and that is no. I mean, we do shame the ministers in the House of Commons, but they, in fact, are quite junior ministers. They just don't carry much weight in their departments. It's a real pity, but I mean, somebody like Zach Goldsmith, he knows his stuff, and he...
You've gone muted, Jenny.
I'm so sorry, I don't know what happened there. But our minister on this bill, as Natalie's just said, is Zach Goldsmith. Now, he knows his stuff, and he knows that what he's saying from the dispatch box in response to all of our amendments that we've just done in committee stage, he knows it's nonsense. Saying, oh, well, this, the Office for Environmental Protection, you know, it's very good and this is great, and it's clearly not. It hasn't got enough powers, hasn't got enough resources. And he must go back to DEFRA and say, you've got to get me out of this. Can we accept some of these, and, you know, can we give way? They are shameless, this government, shameless.
Gloria is of the view that Zach, who was her MP, has sold his soul to the bridge.
I don't think I disagree with that, although Jenny and I don't exactly share views on that. But nonetheless, I don't want to be too discouraging, because as we saw with the government giving way on the state of nature, if you have a concerted public campaign, and what NGOs and campaign groups have increasingly got good at is the Tory party, although in the Commons they have a majority of 80, that's far from a stable majority for a whole range of reasons. They've got lots of rebels often for different reasons and not always the kind of people who are on our side. But nonetheless, if they feel like there's more and more pressure on them, they may give way. So we won't necessarily get what we want, but we'll shift things slightly in the right direction. So, I don't want this to be a council of despair. It's well worth, watching out for, writing to your own local MP, particularly if they're a Tory MP, telling them you're interested in this issue and that issue. And it's really good if you can write your own email rather than just using a stock NGO campaigning email. And if you don't get a decent response from them, one of my suggestions has always been, some Tory MPs I know well just have to provide decent responses to challenges. What's a good thing to do in that point, I always suggest, is write a letter to the editor of your local paper saying, not getting angry, not sounding very, very reasonable, saying how terribly disappointed you were that you as a constituent approached your MP who's supposed to represent them and they didn't reply or they didn't give you an adequate reply and here's what happened. And that's the kind of thing that helps. It's all pressure. It's all shifting the goalposts rather than necessarily getting an absolute win.
Also, of course, telling other people that they can do the same and chase. I'm not in the business of defending Zach Goldsmith, but I would just say at least he's still there and still working. There's loads of people who take their peerage and run, Botham, all sorts of people, they don't work in the house. They don't do anything. It's very annoying.
So, connected to this, Tom Hayek has asked the question, who are the Conservative Party backbench allies, if any, in the Commons when it comes to ping pong on this?
I've got no idea. Because, it just depends on the particular issue. For example, weirdly, we've got quite a few allies in the Lords on the issue of animal welfare, animal sentience and that sort of thing, from unexpected, from hardline Tories. And they come out with, it is one of the things that Natalie and I have done a lot of, and that is, get Tories on our side. As she described on the, when you get the amendments and you get a Tory to sign up, and we've done a lot of work on that, because it does freak the government out. The first amendment that I ever got accepted was because I joined up with a Tory, a sort of hardline right-wing Tory, and we agreed on something. So, it's a way of getting things done. But in the Commons, I just don't know. Caroline might know. We could ask her.
Yeah, I mean, I would say it is worth saying, as Jenny was saying, there is lots of people in the Lords who are allies in varying degrees to varying levels, and I actually did it on Times Radio at the weekend. They've got a slot that's called Frenemies, Friends and Enemies, and so I did that with Lord Randall of Uxbridge, who many might know as a campaigner against HS2, and he's also very much a kind of nature influenced campaigner. And one of the funny in a not quite not ha-ha kind of way things was I used that to ask him, so why are you sitting on the benches opposite us? And he's a back in the sort of major Thatcher days was an MP, and he's very much a one nation, traditional old style kind of Tory. And so I said, why are you sitting on those benches? And he said, well, I don't really know entirely. And there's quite a few like that in the Lords.
He also was environmental advisor to Theresa May. And she, of course, put Natalie into the House. So, he might have had an impact there.
Okay. So next question from Steve C. How much overlap is there in amendments such as the idea of Future Generations Bill? Is that incorporated into this at all?
The Future Generations Bill is a private member's bill being moved by John Bird, who's a crossbench non-party member who was the founder of The Big Issue, for those who don't know. And it reflects what's happening in Wales, where there is a Future Generations Act, which is, but you know, is not nearly as strong as it should be. The Welsh Greens can tell you lots of detail about why it's not strong enough, but nonetheless has had some significant impact. And I actually know that, I don't think he tabled it at committee stage, but he has actually got down at report stage an amendment that says you will consider future generations. So there is some joining up happening. So what you often get is people come at an issue from lots of different ways with lots of different angles. So there'll be private members' bills, the kind of amendments we're putting down to the environment bill. Sometimes you feel like you could just get out a recording and hit the play button, because the same things as we said in the agriculture bill, the same things as we said in the trade bill, some of the things I've been saying in the finance bill, I'm now saying here too. The same issues come back and back, and one of the things you're aiming to do is just wear away at the government and make them feel like they've really got to do something about this because everyone's yelling at them about it.
The second time he put the bill down, he couldn't get to house or something, so he asked us to do it. So I think it was me on that occasion. So I presented it. So you know, it is good to work with other people, especially crossbenchers.
Okay. Got a really interesting question from Dan Osborne here. He's saying a major weakness of the Environment Bill is a lack of any real link to the forthcoming Planning Bill. Amendments in the Commons were voted down. Ministers' arguments in this respect were very weak. What is the position in the Lords on this?
I think that might be mine, actually. I tend to do planning. I'm just looking for it on our list, and I actually can't... we've got housing targets and net zero targets.
You've gone mute again, Jenny.
I think it's a host keeps muting me, Holly.
Not me, I swear.
Right, sorry. I can't remember how much I don't know how much you heard, but we have done a bit on it, but not very much. And quite honestly, when you look at the list of things that we try to cover, only in this bill, it's absolutely huge. And we did try to get stuff in on the agriculture bill. For example, I tried to get air pollution in, but, you know, it's really easy to miss deadlines and miss opportunities because there's only two of us. And we would love some company. That's all I can say.
I think so, some of the debate was that there were some amendments around the power of local authorities and the interaction of local authorities, local nature plans. And it's not an area that I confess I'm deeply embedded in. I covered it a little bit, but you know, as Jenny said, we are in a problem whereby, as the Earl of Devon, who's a crossbench hereditary peer, said, you know, this is our bill and you know, we've been all over it. But to do sort of, you know, the House sometimes, there have been days when we started at 1:30 and finished at midnight with a half hour break somewhere in the middle of that. And we just speak in group after group after group. And it's just, you know, anything you can say we need more green peers, you know, as well as, of course, needing a properly elected democratic House. These are things we just keep saying.
I'm going to agree with that, being on the Lord's list, but pretty far down it. But there we go. Anyway, another question from Dan. I think it's a good question. It's a $65 million question, or whatever it happens to be. Will the Office of Environmental Protection have any real teeth?
We are trying to ensure that it does. But obviously the government don't want it to have real teeth because then they would have to listen to it. So, and this is something that a lot of peers are tackling. So we will do our best to get. If you're interested in this, you could follow us on Facebook and things like that, because it does come up there. What we're doing and so on. And also, of course, you can access all the stuff on the intranet, the parliamentary internet. The real problem with the Office for Environmental Protection is that, as I say, the government doesn't want it to be able to do anything. It doesn't want them, it doesn't want to threaten judicial reviews of government decisions and that sort of thing, even though the office will presumably have a lot of expertise. But we are struggling with it at the moment.
Comparisons with the European Union may be helpful in this area, perhaps. Yeah.
Well. And interestingly, of course, when we had the European Union and the European Commission enforcing EU directives, one of the big issues that I think there's going to be a huge fight over, because it's an issue that brings in lots of our legal eagles, because we've mentioned several times the crossbenchers, which is the non-party people. A significant number of those are actually former chief, the high chief justices and all this sort of stuff. And they're people who have a lot of weight and are very much listened to, particularly by the other crossbenchers. And one issue that's going to be big fight over is whether the OEP can actually hold the government to account, or whether essentially the government is exempted from its own regulation. And this is an issue that actually goes way beyond the Environment Bill, because the rule of law says that rules will apply to everyone without fear or favour, and that is supposed to include the government and government officials. And by actually excluding the OEP from being able to act on government action, they're actually destroying a centuries-old legal principle. And so I think our legal eagles will really be all over that, and that's somewhere where there's certainly going to be a big fight about, and I'd expect there will be an amendment going back to the Commons on that.
The minute the legal guys get involved, the whole House listens. And we managed to stop some things before because the legal odds were so tough on it. So they are a fantastic asset.
We've got a next question is from Rosamond Kissy Deborah, the air quality campaigner. Hi, Jenny and Natalie. Can you please support my amendment in the Environment Bill on air quality? A direct ask.
Right. I haven't seen it. Have you put it with somebody already, Rosamond?
We can unmute Rosamond if we want and bring her in.
Hello. Can you hear me, Jenny?
Can hear you, Rosamond.
Yeah, Rosamond. So who are you sending the amendment to?
Lord Kennedy. And it's going to be based on the coroner's his PFD, which includes the WHO limit. So I'm trying that way.
Okay, no, that's fair enough, because Roy Kennedy is the Labour front bench person. He'll hand it over to somebody else, I think. And I might already have put my name down for it. That's a possibility. But anyway, even if our name isn't on an amendment, we are able to speak on that amendment.
Okay.
But I'm putting down my own because what we sometimes do as a pair of Greens is we try to, Natalie's got this phrase about opening the Overton window, i.e. that we put down more radical amendments than anybody else, with the idea that then their radical amendment actually becomes quite moderate. So I don't think you'll be disappointed in what we do on air pollution, but whether or not we get those amendments through is a completely different matter.
He thinks he's confident about getting support across the House. And it is the same thing, as you know, the WHO limits, which at the moment, the government are not budging on that. So I'm just trying it this way, but I'm trying to drum up support. And okay. I would like to meet Zach Goldsmith, if that's possible. Like you say, he probably, I don't know whether air pollution is his thing, but I thought if I could meet him and at least try and convince him.
Not in our power, Rosamond.
Well, actually, I have asked him and he said, I think he said he would, didn't he? It must be in Hansard. I'll check that for you, Rosamond. I'm having a meeting with Clean Air London on Monday, a lawyer, and so we're going to create radical options for the government. Okay.
All right then, Jenny and Natalie, thank you very much.
Thanks, Rosamond.
Thanks, Rosamond. And just to sort of pull on to that point, Jenny's point about putting down radical amendments, one of the things that I think we've made some real progress on is I put down two amendments on ecocide. Okay. And many people might know that there's a call to add to the Rome statutes as a parallel to genocide to create the offence of ecocide. And this was something that actually, it struck me that this is something we could do with the Environment Bill. And I approached the ecocide campaigners. Mm-hmm. And I actually put down two amendments in the committee. One of which said we will back the international, or the UK will back the international campaign to create this global offence of ecocide, mm-hmm. To be heard before the International Criminal Court. And what happened was I then later, because they've just brought out a whole lot of very high level international jurists worked out a new definition of ecocide that the proposal, what they put into that Rome statute. Mm-hmm. I also put down a proposal that we actually write that straight into UK law and create an offence of UK of ecocide within the UK. And that's okay. One of the first times around the world that's been done. And what I'm not making any secret of this, it's my intention to, we don't very often push things to a vote ourselves when we don't expect to win them. But I've put it on the record that I'm intending to push that the international side of that to a vote when we get to report stage. Mm-hmm. So I think it's such an important thing. And as far as I'm aware, the Lib Dems currently aren't on record on this at all. Mm-hmm. I got backing in my amendment from Rosie Boycott, who's a crossbencher, who's a very good campaigner on a lot of the issues we work on, and Baroness Whittaker, who's Labour, but she wasn't formally representing Labour. But I think there's quite a lot of backing. It's a really big international issue. And so we've got quite a lot of international coverage, and we've kind of pushed Britain to the front of this against the government's wishes. So we're going to keep pushing on it.
All right. Thank you.
Good stuff. Let's move on to the next question, which is from Edward Gildea. Does the bill refer to things like biodiversity plus? In which case, what metric do they use to measure biodiversity? Does the metric include the microorganisms of our soil on which we all food chains depend? Or does it just count big things like trees?
Well, again, I'll put in the chat box in a second a speech in the debate that I made on this. We had a really, really interesting, very high quality debate, and there was an excellent contribution from Lords Krebs, who's another very respected crossbencher, where we discussed what biodiversity is. And it was interesting because the Labour front bencher at the end of this debate said, gosh, I've learned a lot from this debate that I hadn't realised. And I raised the very issue you're talking about, and some people in this call may know that my first degree is agricultural science, and I can get very, very geeky about soils. And I'm quite proud of the fact that I was the first person to ever get the word tardigrades mentioned in Hansard, which I did in my maiden speech. But we also talked about how biodiversity, often when people talk about biodiversity, they mean, oh, we're preserving this really rare moth. And, you know, there's three nature reserves in the country where this rare moth is surviving. But of course, biodiversity exists within species as well. As you said, it exists within microorganisms, within ecosystems. And so we had a really good debate on this in the House, and no, the bill doesn't allow this at the moment. And actually an amendment I've already put down for report stage, quite astonishingly, clause one of the bill, which sets out what the purposes of this bill are, say its purposes are to look after water and air quality, but there is no mention of soil. And so I have a simple amendment that says one of the key aims of this bill is to look after soil quality and soil health. And that's an amendment that I led on, and I got some backing from some somewhat surprising places, including it always surprises me somehow or other when the Duke of Wellington comes out to back my amendments. There's something about, I always think of, you know, the Napoleonic era Duke of Wellington when you say Duke of Wellington, and I find it rather odd. But the Duke of Wellington is actually quite into organic farming and quite positive about some of these issues. And this, again, is something I'm thinking of pushing to a vote, and I think might even be winnable given the range of support we got in committee.
Yeah, I did like the idea of him out in his field with his Wellington boots, but there
we go. I think we can add to that, except that the fact that Natalie's got the First Amendment in the bill down, the first clause one, First Amendment, I think it's rather nice that a Green kicks off the whole bill at report stage. It's very good.
Interesting question from Sheila Heyman. 15 years ago, the Stern report said almost all the same things, including changing how things are costed and valued and the enormous costs of doing nothing. How can we incorporate it into those principles here, and how can we make it different this time?
Seriously, well, it's different because there's two Greens in the House of Lords now. There were Greens before, but they weren't appointed. And so we would do our best. That's all I can say. But with this idea that we are always pushing the more radical agenda, it is dragging people after us. But even the floods in Northwest Europe, even the heat waves in British Columbia and you know, the fact that our supermarket shelves are being denuded because we can't get food in fast enough, it doesn't panic the government. I mean, most Greens are in a state of mild panic the whole time. Well, I am personally, because of what's happening. But the government just doesn't get that. And so we do say things like, you know how much it's going to cost to not do this. Sorry, the other way around. You know how much it's going to cost if we carry on as we are, but you've got no idea how much it will cost if we don't do this stuff. And the floods and the heat waves are an example. But we do our stuff. We try.
And just to add to that, one of the amendments that I ran with was actually an amendment that came from Caroline Lucas's office. So she'd already tabled it and she had some cross-party backing down in the Commons. And I'll probably be bringing this back again, probably in a slightly varied form. But we're basically saying to replace GDP as a goal in terms of the whole government target. And I pointed to, as I keep pointing to, the New Zealand Treasury, which has actually explicitly a guidelines, the living standards framework, which takes in that complete, you know, economic poverty, inequality issues, environmental issues, brings them all together and says the Treasury will have to consider all of these things, not as our Treasury basically does, what's it going to do for GDP? And so we've got that amendment, which has been down. And it's interesting, again, I'll stick it in the chat box. Zach Goldsmith basically got up and agreed and said, yes, I agree. And, you know, I've got a bit of a debate running. I did get the Treasury actually to respond in a different debate, an economic debate. I can't remember which one now, but I was talking about donut economics. And they actually came back and quoted me, Lord Agnew, a different book that says, oh, well, we're just going to improve our resource use efficiency. And so I've now just managed to kick off a little bit of a debate with the Treasury to get the Treasury Minister to engage in this. You know, what they say is nonsense, but at least they're engaging. And that's what actually being in the House means we're able to do, is to force them to come up with some response. And some civil servant is actually first forced to read this and think about it. And that's a kind of progress and does make some difference.
Okay. Next question is from Paul Mines. Does the draft bill cover the legally binding target on net zero and how it is to be met?
Oh God, I can't remember. Can you remember, Natalie?
Well, no, because basically this is all in the Climate Change Act. So the Environment Bill, weirdly enough, is not explicitly about climate, because we have all of that covered in the 2008 Climate Change Act. And as updated by the government, we're giving the net zero 2050 target. Now, we all know all the problems with that. And we know the problems, but it is, I think, from my now experience of a couple of years in the House of Lords, I mean, it is an innate problem of government that you have a bill that has, one of the things the bill has is what's called the long title, which describes what the bill is about. And sometimes when we go to put down amendments, the bill office will say, oh, this is out of scope. This is not included in the long title. It's not covered by the bill. So very explicitly a climate target in this, that's the reaction we would get, you know, if we were to put down an amendment, say, well, actually, we want net zero by 2030. That's not part of the Environment Bill. That's covered by the Climate Change Act. So these things are siloed up. And in some ways, I think that there is some inevitability about that. I don't see how you could possibly write a law that covers everything. Possibly you could write something like the National Living Standards Framework for New Zealand that would kind of be a law that would cover everything. But generally speaking, you're going to have to divide things up. So purely climate emergency things are essentially covered by the Climate Change Act.
I just want to say something about accountability, and that is that one of the things that we're finding is that the government is using more and more Henry VIII powers, and this is a way of sneaking things through that sort of tweak bills that have already gone through and are now acts. And they do it because we can have a debate on this. They call them statutory instruments, but we can't actually alter them. And so again and again, the government is tweaking stuff without any, well, we try to give it democratic oversight, but we can't actually change it. And there's some of that stuff is in this bill. Actually, the more I'm talking, the more sort of I'm thinking, oh God, how are we ever going to get anything through? But we'll try.
I can see that Boris Johnson might be in some ways trying to model himself on Henry VIII.
Yeah.
But
in his waist.
There are certain things, aren't there? Anyway, next question. Dan Osborne. Caroline Lucas put forward an amendment in the Commons to stop the potential to rewrite the Habitats Regulation. Her amendment said they could be added to, not amended. What's happened in the Lords on that?
I think there's a number of amendments that have been put down on this, and essentially I can remember giving at least two speeches about non-regression clauses, because of course when we, and this comes back to what you were saying, Andrew, about the European Union, the government was talking about Brexit, when Brexit campaigners were talking about Brexit, they were promising we would have non-regression from European Union standards. What's happened on that? Well, the short answer is something that comes up in lots of other debates, which is we have an Australian trade deal, which includes very clear regression on animal welfare standards, on food standards, on environmental standards of farming. And it's something that, speaking obviously for anyone who doesn't know, that's where my accent comes from occasionally, originally in my first degree is agricultural science. So I actually wrote a piece for the Yorkshire Post, getting pretty scathing, although I did have to think about people potentially reading it at breakfast, about what happens in the standards of Australian farming. And this is going to, Australian farmers are going to be undercutting British farmers with practices like mulesing, M-U-L-E-S-I-N-G. You can look it up, but it basically involves a significant operation on lambs without anaesthetic that leaves them in very considerable pain for days and days and days. Horrendous. The standards of Australian farming are vile. They use hormone treated beef. It's a huge issue, and basically the government has resisted and will, I have no doubt, sadly, will continue to resist every attempt at non-regression, because their whole ideology is free trade and let rip. And this, of course, ties into the Northern Ireland Protocol that I was relating to yesterday, and why the EU will maintain the Northern Ireland Protocol, because otherwise there's a backdoor for all those products to come into the EU.
On this issue of animal welfare, it's quite bizarre, because the National Farmers Union, which is not a natural ally for us, we are basically on the same side as them, because we do care about the big farmers as well as the small farmers. You'll all be pleased to know that I'm actually writing down the things that you're bringing up that we don't actually, that we haven't actually thought of. Well, not thought about, but that we haven't specifically done work on. So habitats goes on the, we have worked on it, but not quite under that heading. Yeah.
Okay. Next question, Sue Lee Richards. Given the agriculture bill and the environmental land management systems includes public money for public good, do you think they will ultimately align with the environment bill and deliver quality local food and biodiversity? Net gain.
Yeah, this is one of the problems, actually, that because, as Natalie says, the bills tend to be in silos, and there's no way of getting around that, and it's probably a very sensible, but they don't tie up. And one of the things that we've been stressing is that, the bill should, have a common theme at times, and they shouldn't contradict each other. But we are struggling with that
Okay. Interesting question from Sarah Clayton. What's the connection between the Environment Bill and the CEE Bill? And you're on mute again, Jenny.
I had done it myself then. What we're trying to do is we've been trying to bring amendments or bits of that bill into this bill. And so it's sort of scattered through. And actually, the CEE bill has been an incredible source of ideas and enthusiasm, because so many people know about it that they will help put the pressure on with this bill as well.
And a really great question from Thomas Bell. What, if anything, does the Environment Bill mean for local authorities? Loads, actually. Absolutely loads. But please tell
us. You can answer that.
Well, certainly all the waste regulations, that's going to be a huge impact on local authorities, particularly some of the contracts we've got.
And planning.
Yeah, off we go. All the things associated with that.
Yeah, I mean, bottle deposit schemes. Sorry, I can get really into the weeds on this, but I'll try not to get too far into the weeds. Bottle deposit schemes, one of the issues is that local authorities will potentially lose significant amounts of revenue from recycling if we go to a situation whereby what you have is going through companies, and you have, you know, each supermarket has a machine, as many parts of continental Europe do, where you put your bottles in, you know, next time you go back to the supermarket, you put your bottles in and get your money deposit back. And that's going to potentially be a system that's operating in a different way and have significant impacts on local authority revenue through the waste stream. And I mentioned the working with the Nappy Alliance, a very significant percentage, and of course going up all the time, of residual waste is single-use nappies. And that's a very major cost to local authorities. So one of the reasons why I'm working on that bill, on that bit of the bill, I mean, there's many reasons why we should be doing much more to support reusable nappies, one of which is the cost to families of single-use over the 2.5 years average that it is in nappies is £11 a week. For many families, that's a huge saving that could be made, that could be put to better purposes, as well as all the environmental impacts. It could also save a very large amount of money for local authorities. And, you know, if we've all been on litter picks, we all know how unpleasant it is if you encounter a single-use nappy on a litter pick. You know, these are things we really need to do something about, and they could have a positive impact for local authorities.
Wakefield Council have a reusable nappy scheme, and I'm going to have a look at that and see if we can emulate it in our own council.
Very good. There's also the fact that a lot of local authorities send stuff, residual waste, they send it to incinerators. And of course, what happens is they have to keep up a level of waste to send to the incinerators, and they're locked in 20, 30-year contracts. And that does mean that their recycling rates start to go down because they're having to fulfill this quota. So there's all sorts of, as you say, all sorts of impacts.
Okay. Question from Sheila Heyman, which I guess we could answer in all sorts of different ways. But our MP is Keir Starmer, who has postponed our meeting with him 4 times, and according to his office, has never heard of the ecological emergency. Is there any chance of educating Labour?
It's incredibly difficult. I will say that I think Labour in House of Lords is farther along the understanding than the National Party. And I'm sure to some extent that is our influence, if I can claim that. But something I've seen, because I've been there nearly 8 years now, and something I've seen very clearly is that from about 2 years ago, which of course is when Natalie came in, so it could be down to her, the whole influence of XR, Extinction Rebellion, and Greta Thunberg, somehow it created a sort of, the climate became in the news again and again and again. And of course, a huge criticism of XR, huge criticism of Greta from some areas. But the fact was, it was talked about, and that has made a difference. And I mean, the words climate change come very naturally these days from Conservatives, Labour, Lib Dems, from all around the house. It really is a marked difference. But the big problem, I would say, with Keir Starmer, because I met him a few times when he was DPP and on platforms and so on, is that he's an incredibly ethical person, you know, very noble ideas, but he's not brave enough to strike out, and that's what Labour needs to do. I mean, most of us want a Labour government rather than a Conservative government, but it's, you know, it's difficult to see the difference at the moment. And so good luck with your meeting, and take along a Green Party manifesto.
Just to reflect on what Jenny said in terms of her experience in the House, I mean, it's interesting because I have never actually heard in my nearly 2 years in the House a climate change denier getting up and delivering a climate change denial speech. What happens in the House of Lords is things just become beyond the pale and people won't say them anymore. And that's something that, you know, has very clearly changed. And I very much agree with Jenny that XR and the climate strikers have been a big thing in that. In terms of Keir Starmer and that meeting, you might have to make a judgment call on this, but again, I'd suggest you might want to write utterly in sorrow, not at all in anger, to your local paper expressing disappointment at, you know, you really want this meeting to happen and, you know, it should be a priority, et cetera, et cetera. So that would be, think about that. I mean, obviously that has a risk of damaging your relationships, but it might be worth thinking about, or even just telling the telling Keir's staffers that that's, you were thinking about doing that and perhaps the meeting could get scheduled now. And that might be a way of making that happen. But also just to reflect on the fact that the Labour is wedded to growth. There was a really interesting article three or four years back now in the Financial Times, but the Financial Times said there's essentially nothing different between Theresa May and Jeremy Corbyn, who were then their respective leaders, because they both believe in growth, they just want to distribute it differently. And there is a very profound truth in there. Labour does not grasp, I'm not saying there's not individual Labour members who don't, but Labour overall doesn't grasp that you can't have infinite growth on a finite planet. That's just simply not within their mindset. They believe that you have to get the pie that everyone's sharing out has to get bigger and bigger, and so then the people who are getting crumbs will get some more crumbs. That's the foundation of their political philosophy. We instead say the pie can only be a certain size and we've got to carve it up fairly so that everyone gets a decent slice. And, you know, we understand there's enough resources on this planet for everyone to have a decent life if we just share them out fairly. Labour doesn't understand that. It's why they're not fundamentally a radical party, as I would say we are.
They tend to believe in the trickle down economics, when really a lot of economics is trickled on, really. But there we go. Thomas Bell, given that environmental governance is largely a devolved matter and that the Environment Bill applies to England, how concerned should we be about the Environment Bill creating fragmentation between the nations and more regulatory complexity?
Well, it's obvious that Scotland and Wales are much more active on this issue, on almost every issue, than we are in England. So the fragmentation could occur, but it's to our detriment. It won't be to their detriment, I wouldn't have thought. I was in a debate before I joined this call, and it was on, it sounded quite a dry debate, but I put my name down for it. I think Natalie got me to put my name down for it, actually. It was a select committee, and quite honestly, it was just astonishing how that select committee, which is made up of all different parties and none, actually were talking about inequality and how damaging that is for all aspects of, I mean, obviously I came in and said, yeah, it's damaging for climate change as well, because people, you know, don't have, you know, you have to make it easy for people to do the right thing. And it struck me then that there were Tories talking about lifting people out of poverty and how inequality is very damaging and that sort of thing. And, you know, you can't trust Tories anymore to be right-wing Tories. You just can't, you know. So I would imagine that on the Environment Bill, we will make a little progress, but probably not as much as, you know, we would like, and probably not as much as Scotland and Wales will be able to achieve.
I mean, on that specific question of the problems, lots of issues around the devolved administrations and the nations of these islands fall to me. It's something that I've sort of picked up as an area, and I'm trying to get my head around. And I think there is going to be some very clear border issues. You know, they're the same arguments we were making with Brexit. Fish don't swim up to a national border and stop. Birds don't get to a national border and stop. Rivers flow back and forth. Water flows across. And there's going to be really significant border issues. And there's a real problem with the relationship between the Westminster government and the Holyrood government and the Senate and the Welsh government. That basically the Westminster is just trying to ride roughshod over them. And so it's going to be a very, as our relationship with the EU is, it's going to be, there's going to be lots of wrestles, lots of tussles. And of course, there is a real problem in terms of there's a huge imbalance of power in that situation. All we can do is keep highlighting the issues and keep saying, you know, as Greens, we believe in localism. We just believe decisions should be made as locally as possible by the people affected and only referred upwards when absolutely necessary. There's something called the Dunlop Review that looked at the relationships between the nations of the UK and the governments of the UK. And it's a very moderate review. It's not very extreme at all in many ways, but I was in a debate on that. And, you know, even lots of people there were saying, well, you know, people who utterly support the union were saying, well, we've got to fix some of these things or it's going to be a real problem.
Okay. There's a question from Ozzy, which is basically asking, is there a resume of the bill? Is there a handy resume that we can have? And some of the principal arguments that Greens are making about it. Is that something that exists anywhere and where we're focusing our efforts?
Jenny, you wrote the piece for Green World, was it? Where was it?
Yes, Green World. So there should be something online about that. I'm just wondering if we ought to put out bulletins or something so that people know where we are on all this. Trouble is, it moves so fast at times. But that might be an idea. Is that something people would actually like to have, to, you know, sort of bulletins to catch up with what we're doing? And
people are saying yes in the chat. We'll see how many yeses we get in the chat in the next.
It is worth saying that Jenny and I put out an email newsletter every couple of months or so, and indeed we did put out one on the sort of in the middle stage of the committee debate. I'll try and track down a link to that in a second. The problem is this is such a portmanteau, broad-reaching bill that, you know, as Rosamond came on and said, you know, what about air pollution? There's a whole enormous issue about air pollution. For example, I'm working with a campaigner, some people might know, called Georgina Downs, on issues around pesticides. And there's a whole enormous area around the use of pesticides, particularly pesticides close to people's homes. It's a whole area we haven't even mentioned, which is the debate we had on the last day about forest destruction and forest products, and introducing a rule for due diligence for companies to ensure that they're not importing products into the UK that come from deforested areas. And so there's all so many different areas in this bill. It's hard to say this is just this one thing.
One thing you can do is look us up in Hansard, so you can follow us, all the written words, and you can search for our names, that sort of thing. Another option is that you watch Parliament TV occasionally. It's absolutely riveting. I would recommend it. And one of the problems with putting out regular updates, and we do our best, but it does take resources. And if the choice is between giving resources to actually fighting the government on this bill, or it's letting people know, we tend to just go for, because we can't, no one else can do what Natalie and I can do. It's not as if we can step down and say, oh, look, Andy's better on this subject, let him answer the questions. Nobody else can speak in the House apart from us for the Green Party. So that's why we tend to focus on that. And between us, we have, actually, I'm not sure now, so we've got somebody else. Is it like 1.5 days a person, 1.5 days a week, except it's four people who all work part time. So we're not very well resourced.
I think it is worth saying that we both have websites, we both have lots of social media presence. So rather than being able to do one summation, we may have, you know, if you follow those things, you will see what we're doing a lot. I'm afraid we're going to have to go, and I've got to go back to the house in a minute anyway. So I think we're just about to the roundup stage. But, do get involved, get engaged. And, I've got a hashtag campaigning works, and everything everyone on this call does as an individual, all the things we've talked about, using social media, writing letters to the paper, it's all the drip, drip, drip that makes a difference. So my saying is always, and people on this call obviously do this, but make politics what you do, not have done to you. The more people we can get involved and engaged in the Environment Bill and everything else, the better.
And contacting us directly on all this sort of stuff is probably not a good idea. If you can, go through a policy working group, because then it's sort of filtered and we get what a lot of people think and want us to do. So best not to just find your pet subject. I'm sure there'll be a working group somewhere for you. And if not, set one up.
Okay, so a big thank you, I'm sure, from all of us to Natalie and Jenny for all the work that you're doing. I'm sorry we weren't able to get to all the questions, but feel free to get in touch with Natalie and Jenny outside this meeting. We did try to cover quite a lot of the areas that people were interested in. So do get involved. Do keep an eye on what's going on, and we'll also be working through the party to promote the work that Natalie and Jenny are doing, working with Caroline in Parliament. And let's do good things, as always.
Thank you, Andy.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks for your question. Bye.